Could you ever conceive of a circumstance in which the Police would do a reunion tour?
I think that'd be a good course to have me certified insane.
Dealing with for many years now.
The Police has always been my favorite music experience. It's a no-brainer for me. The part that I have no comprehension of is what made Sting decide that this is the hour, this is the day, this is the moment.
I'm always of the belief that surprise is everything in this business.
What would really surprise people, would even surprise me, is if I reformed the Police. And so it was.
Even right now, it still feels slightly unreal.
I didn't believe it until Sting emails the set list. I'm looking at all these songs. That is the moment when I started running around my studio hollering.
What is important is that we always were a bit of unfinished business.
Okay.
Alrighty, Pop. Should we just do that again, just for the hell of it, or move on?
Yeah, we should do it.
We can do it.
I think we figured a few things out in message. I don't remember what they are.
What was good about the Crash Bash was that we got a good dynamic downshift for the first verse.
Yeah.
So the intro being loud was kind of good.
I mean, but if it's just loud for your drum solo,
yeah,
then the riff was
yeah, absolutely.
Is little. Let's try that. No, I meant small, right there. Go really small there.
There.
Yeah, let's try it.
It started out miserable, which took us all by surprise. We were all, I think, expecting it to be a lot easier than it was.
So at the end of the chorus, what I'm hoping to hear is the bass drum on two, and that's the main thing. So... Bow, bow.
This is the coda?
Yeah.
Okay, so you don't want it to continue anymore.
Well...
Now you want something different.
You know, it's hard to, without writing all down, I don't know. All I want is the bass drum. That's what I want to hear on two.
So I have to sort of limit my, you know, band leader kind of mentality. For a start, I'm now in a band where I can't fire anybody. I can't fire anybody, you know. So I better negotiate. I'd better argue my case. I'd have to, you know, present things and, you know, be diplomatic. For a change. I mean, you have to ask the other two how they feel about it.
What's your feeling about your co-workers and your bandmates, right?
I hate them both, you know. Yeah. So that's it. Next
good.
Question.
Okay.
It's become such almost a cliche about, you know, our relationship. Oh, these guys hate each other. I hope they're not going to stab each other in the throat tonight, you know. It's a half-truth.
That's gonna be fucking cover of Modern Drummer magazine is gonna be fucking devoted to that drum fill,
well,
you cunt.
It's amazing that you could play that drum fill in 9 beats.
Right, huh?
It's fantastic.
Just because you get lost, just because it's a little confusing for the fucking bass playing element. Okay?
It's going so well, too.
It was amazing when we got back here in this room how, you know, where's that jugular?
Can I tell you something, Andrew? I love you.
I love you too, Sting.
but. You know, if you're singing unison with somebody, the best way of getting to in unison is to watch their mouth.
All right, I'm not looking at you that
way. I know you're
that,
not. But, when we're on stage, you're going to see that. But as we're together like this, it's a good opportunity to actually start singing together.
I was actually singing in tune. Too.
You were singing in tune, but you weren't singing with me.
We're making that effort to communicate in a way that will hold us together so we can get through these very rough time of refashioning our musical bond.
See, if we can get through this, it's much better than paying a shrink, you know, $400 an hour in New York.
Okay.
That was the end.
Okay. Time for Tonto's expanding headband.
Yeah, for some of us, the 60s never left.
Why are you wearing that?
Here, sir.
Sweat, mate. Because somebody up, look at you cool as a cucumber on your stool. There's somebody's working here.
I'm sweating.
Okay.
I'm thinking about wearing that on stage.
Not for the Grammys, but for 2 hours of this shit.
I think we need to have a discussion, a band discussion.
This will be discussed.
This is kind of surreal. You with that shit on your head. You'd have casting to, you aspersions know, on my headband.
It's all fine, but you will have to have a discussion you'll have to have a discussion with our personal fashion designer.
Now, since you mention it, he fucking loves the headband.
What about a tennis racket with that?
But why don't we just play tennis? Jeff, what do we have to get up here with these fucking things for? We could be out there.
Come after you with a
on the court.
Racket.
It's a marriage, and you know, it's like any marriage. You know, you work at it, and we've had a history of working at it.
There's a little moment where it goes dun 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 dun. I'd love to. It's very subtle. Doesn't rob the integrity of the song. And I have no fucking idea where it is or what it is. But it might reveal itself if we play it.
Every move that you make, and every vow you break, every smile you fake, every claim you steal, I'll be watching you. Okay. Right there is where you're talking about.
Yes.
All right. I'll give you that if you take the flams out.
Take the flams out.
Blah, blah.
Just a...
Yeah. It's a deal.
It's a deal.
You're so much more civilized than we used to be.
So we need to announce the tour dates, and the usual way to do that is to have a press conference.
Is there anything we can come up with that is a little sexier than just a press conference?
There was some debate about whether we should do that. I was for it because I thought we just have to show our colours here.
Lesson for all the UK bands, keep on practicing. It might work out.
You know, the Whiskey Go-Go is sort of significant because that's where we started. I think it was our second tour of America. It felt like we made it all the way from the underground of London to the Whiskey Go-Go in Los Angeles. It felt like, yes.
Good morning, everybody.
It's pretty intense. The whole the world's media was there. There were queues outside and helicopters flying above us, and everywhere, the police.
Is that tempo okay for you?
It's too fast. I'll stop you. You know that.
I hadn't played a little club in a long time and I just wasn't used to the sound. I mean, you know, I'm used to big places where the sound is enormous. This was the playing in a shoebox.
We're going to go on tour.
The big thing is, clearly, in a lot of people's minds, we broke up too early and left all this, and I suppose there's an attendant pain with that, and I think there's a certain kind of a healing of scar tissue, somewhat, coming back together with this.
Corey Moss with MTV News. I want to know the scope of the reunion. Is it just this tour? Will there be new music? An album, possibly?
World domination, totally, I would say.
We're going to come out, burn down the world. We're going to enslave your children, eat your kings and queens, rape and pillage across the world.
Nothing's changed.
Got one over here.
Sting, you mentioned being a little older and with that wiser. Do you feel like now, you know, with the time apart, you guys have more of an appreciation for playing together this time?
There's no reason why we shouldn't be 25 years better than we were then. And we were good then.
Yeah.
Just really the last question. This is Taylor Hawkins from the Topanga Canyon Tribune.
Yeah. Hey, that's great. That's
awesome. So you got 3 months till the tour starts, right?
Yeah.
You think that we have time for the mullets to return?
The mullets? We never wore mullets.
Yeah.
You fighters wear mullets.
That's a good question.
Yeah, yeah, you're wearing a mullet now.
Somebody asked a serious question.
Anyway, I just want to know, are you guys strictly going to keep it to the Police songs, or are you going to...
Mostly we're going to do U2, you know.
Well, gee, I thought we could do My Sharona. But no, we're keeping it to the Police material, seriously. Not,
Thanks, everyone, and we'll see you in 3 months.
We're spending about 8 hours a day practicing at the moment.
Slowly we're building up the speed. At the moment we're up to, we can get through about 10 or 12 songs in a day, but we need to be able to get through 24 songs in about 2 hours.
We get a glimpse of all this beautiful view on our way to and from rehearsal. You know, we feed ourselves occasionally, but basically we spend all day in that rehearsal room and don't do really much of anything else but rehearse Police songs.
Sense, we don't really need to learn these songs, we've played them millions of times. Coming here to Tuscany to rehearse was more a process of, I think, sort of developing a group psyche. You become tight and you become sort of loose in the way you can play together at the same time, and I think that was really the overall objective. Something crawls on the
side of a dark Scottish lake. It's going very well. We find that after we have, you know, it all goes very well, goes very well, goes very well, and everyone's being very nice, but everybody's being very nice. Then there's another screaming match, and then it's blissful, and that's the cycle.
Good.
It's sounding so much better.
Yeah, it sounds really crisp now.
Well, it is tea time in 5 minutes.
And there's a certain amount of, you know, negotiation and toing and froing, whatever, but generally we are progressing and it's moving ahead.
But it does come back to, you know, every day, how do you relate? How do you relate? You know, can you talk? Can you get along? You know.
So, would you punch me on the other side of my face?
I realized that which ear was that?
This one. No, it was my jaw.
I need them both because they're so valuable.
No, it's not my ear.
Because they hear.
But do I look funny?
Everything.
Do I look funny?
Well, you've always looked kind of funny.
Fuck you.
Sting and I have this polar relationship where we're either screaming at each other or we're hugging and kissing, and in between, stability just feels kind of strange, you know, just to be having a normal conversation. I don't think we ever have normal conversations.
We're having steak tonight.
No, we're having a fight.
Yes. This is a bit foolhardy. Are we insured for this?
We get along great, but mostly it's one extreme or another. You know, because we really appreciate each other, but we drive each other nuts.
You know, my short Neanderthal attention span begins to expire on the fourth hour. And by the way, never mind. Never mind how on is part of the chorus here and part of the coda there, but we won't get into it.
Well, the word on doesn't make any sense on its own. It makes sense when
unless it's part of the coda.
But we stay the same.
General Bradley, 4 letters.
Cunt.
Excellent.
ultimately, the emotional thing in the band is that it's quite chaotic. You know, I would prefer if music was like a game of chess, you know. You go there, and it's all kind of organized, and I like that. I like control. This is more like a game of football where somebody just kicks the ball up in the air and you don't know where it's going
to
go.
All of us have had to give up a lot of control over the music. It's not our personal property anymore. The other thing is that you have to submit to being controlled. I have to put up with the bass player saying to me, can you do that on the hi-hat? What? How long have you been playing? You have an opinion about... Sure I can. Of course I can. It'd be an honor. Thanks for the idea.
I mean, it is sort of a group process, and I think most bands worth their salt go through that. There's a certain amount of tension, you know, tugging to and fro until we arrive at this place where everybody feels like he is authentically being himself, and yet he's part of the team as well.
Here we go, Mustaine!
The thing about going out now, all these years later, that immediately becomes a challenge because we've got to prove it.
It has to live up to the hoopla that you've caused by reforming. Tickets are flying out the window against anybody's expectations. And so we have to just live up to that. You've got to be really good.
There's almost a rivalry of who's going to contribute the most to making the band better than it ever was before, you know? All three of us are out there eating our vitamins, doing our push-ups, just generally stepping up to the plate.
It's opening night in Vancouver. The Police haven't played officially since Melbourne in 1983.
Andy, you ready to walk?
It's time to walk.
That is not a lucky sign. See, that is a lucky sign. I must always drop my sticks before the show, because that's a lucky sign.
And then people will say, well, are you nervous? It's the first night. I say, well, I'm not nervous, but I take what we're about to do very seriously. So I want it to be good, and I want to perform the best I can. I want my colleagues to do the best they can.
Gentlemen, look at you. I'm your referee for tonight's outing. There'll be no kicking, no biting, no hitting below the waist, no eye gouging.
How about headbutting?
That's allowed. Okay. Other than that, I want to wish everybody a nice, safe bout here.
Yeah, all right.
All right, guys, have a good one, man.
All right,
thank you.
All right.
Turn it up.
I will.
All right, plug in. Settle up, boys. Settle up.
In a normal band, the first show's kind of a little bit ropey. Nothing is as good as it was when you rehearsed it because you're barely rehearsed enough. We've been rehearsing for 4 months. We are, in fact, over-rehearsed.
It's not a given. We've rehearsed, but we're probably under-rehearsed.
There is an enormous risk for a band like us that, you know, has become legendary and the mythology's built up over the years, because we could fall flat on our faces, you know, and destroy this myth that's gone on while we haven't been playing. So it's very important that we really play extremely well.
I'll calm myself. I'll give myself a good talking to before we go on, and the others will too.
I just, for 4 months, I've been chewing at the bit, just going berserk. Let's do this thing. Let's get out there. Let's go.
great moment. To go out to this size arena and see it just packed to the rafters and all these vibes of people screaming for us and raising their hands, in a sense, you know, it feels like you've arrived back home. Like, oh, well, this is what I know.
We've spent 4 months rehashing, reconstructing, deconstructing, rearranging, dearranging all of our material. None of it really meant anything until we got in front of that audience. Is what always happens to this particular band. When we get an audience in front of us and we're through the gates, new stuff happens. Roxanne was intended to be like a 3-minute pop song. I think we played Roxanne for about 20 minutes. Whole new things that if we had tried to arrange those in rehearsal, they just wouldn't have happened.
It's going down extremely well. The audiences love it. Even the critics love it. And I'm beginning to. But we're not finished yet. I'm still progressing, I'm still evolving.
Once we left LA and we started to head out into the US, really into the middle of the country, then we were really on tour and it started to get loose and funny, and suddenly it felt like the pressure was off. We were just on tour doing the shows.
Okay. What's it called?
Sunrise.
It's named after the river.
And that's where the clubs are and all that. Yeah, it's like a kind of a cooler, hipper area.
Yeah.
Is our hotel anywhere near it?
Is that like just a furry reflex, Andy, asking where the hot clubs are? Do you actually like...
No, I don't
intend to go out and...
I hear that rock.
Boogaloo at the hot happening clubs.
No, I'm not. I was reading, doing Bible study tonight.
The 20-year gap between then and now has really disappeared. It's in a strange way vaporized.
What happened? Nothing. It's like the interim has disappeared from it. I've had a whole other life, but it seems as if it's been joined. So it's gone. Those 27 years of me out of the police have suddenly evaporated. And it's just one thing. And Andy and I are having the same conversations we had then. The same jokes, the same memories, the same nostalgias.
I think, you know, for all three of us, I mean, it's just probably the most important relationship any of us have had in our lives. I don't know how far one ever goes in your own mind or your own thinking, you know, from a relationship like this.
We have a unique bond. There's a way that we can relax in each other's company that there's nobody else on the planet. We empower each other. We, you know, in each other's presence, we sort of feel like more than just three individuals. It, you know, that's a good feeling. I like the feeling of being with these two guys. But the relationship that we have musically is very different from the relationship that we have socially. And there are two environments. There's almost a line that we go over. As soon as we got instruments in our hands, it's sort of like a dance that we do.
I never thought this was going to be an easy process. It was dysfunctional in the first place, so those problems are still there.
It drives me nuts when you play that push.
I know. And that push that we've added at the front of two or three, that, you know, do, ding, 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 ding. I wonder why that's there. It's the sort of thing you usually...
Well, then you put another one straight after it.
Well, it's because it always throws me off, and I'm off, and I wonder why we have added that to the arrangement when it's already a little neat with kind of accents and pushes and stops and starts and stuff.
Well, there are two separate issues here. There's that one.
Yeah, and then the fact
it.
That the result of that... It's so important for me to make Sting happy, because he's really important to me. For the whole first part of this tour, achieving that was very difficult. All of my instincts take me into realms that don't make Sting happy. And that's sort of what we have to deal with.
I don't even know what you're talking about.
Well, Stuart will say he hates jazz, but you know, he's brought up on jazz. He plays like a jazz drummer. He improvises. Andy's the same. I'm much more organized than my musicality. And that's not to say it's better, it's just different. We just think differently.
It's difficult. You know, I don't say that in the intervening years we've grown any wise or actually mature, you know, God forbid.
Sorry.
So we still have to work at it.
We're wasting our time.
To tour well takes a certain amount of discipline. It's like playing an instrument. I mean, the tour itself is like this giant instrument and you've got to plan how to play it. Children, we're concerned for the future, and this is at least something that we can do. This is where we can use what we do to help promote that.
We're the last on, so it's kind of these things. What usually happens is everybody gets on stage, and we're fighting over the microphones and singing songs they don't know. So we said, let's just have a couple of people. So we got Kanye West, who's going to rap. We got John Mayer, who's going to play guitar with Andy.
I'm playing a lot of Guitar Hero, so I know that it's red, green, blue, yellow, red, green, blue, yellow.
Thank God. You know the basic idea. Okay, so the harmony part starts. Now you won't really be able to hear it on this, but.
Did you see the two songs that follow?
Wow, okay. Flat 5. E flat A, E natural. This one, see? Yeah, yeah, so it's up.
After all that, throw your hands in the air like this.
Because right about there would be a real natural place for us to kick it into the next section.
It's still just the third verse, right?
Yeah, this is the third, and I'll do the third verse then.
Okay. So when you're kind of coming to the one, you're at the end of what you got ready,
John,
give us a look and we'll kick it into the next thing.
So I'll just walk over to you like, yeah. Yeah.
You know, that's how we do it. Okay, it ain't rocket science. Just Sting goes, okay, this time!
No!
Right into the mic.
Wrong! Not this time, you idiot!
This gong is bigger than Neil Peart's gong.
That makes you pretty cool,
yeah?
Right?
Okay. Bigger even than John Bonham's gong.
Is there a...
Don't think for a minute that I need a big gong. Because I don't.
No.
But I have one.
I'm going to take a little turn.
60-minute interview. Does that mean it's going to take 60 minutes?
Yeah. So did you enjoy the show last night?
Yeah, no, there's no hot spots at all. It was fun.
Did you?
Yeah,
it's good. It's noisy.
Why are people interested in this band? You know, the obvious thing is the music, you know, and we've had hit records. But it's possible that there is more to it because people are people and it's the human interest that captures the public's imagination.
Okay.
You happy, James? I'm happy, thank you.
Yep. Okay, we're set, Tara.
I'm in speed, Paul.
Yep.
Great. We've started now, just so you know. The second time round. How are you doing things differently?
We're doing things differently in that we're kinder to each other. We understand each other a little more. If something is not perfect, then I don't get uptight and say it has to be perfect. It doesn't have to be perfect. It has to be what we do. And it's an interesting psychological test for me, in a way. Because although we get on as people, there are difficult issues, personality issues. And we're the same guys we were 25 years ago.
You know, I'm noisy and shallow. Sting is quiet and deep. On that level, we appreciate each other deeply. But when I'm around Sting, I have to be careful not to... Because, like, if my elbow's moving, his rib's going to be in the way. If I'm holding a large beer, some of it is going to get on Sting.
I mean, there's clearly... obvious differences. I mean, Stuart's a very outspoken person, and you know he would cop to that in a second. Sting is more inner, and they're sort of like night and day in that respect. And I'm wherever you want to put me. You know. I have plenty to say, but I sometimes like a lot of space too.
Who has the biggest ego, do you reckon?
The biggest ego. Well, no. I, speaking for myself, am nothing. I am no one. Andy also, I'm sure that he would claim to be even less. Mm-hmm. And Sting is a man of great humility who considers himself hardly an atom in the universe. Mm-hmm. That is because we all recognize the enormity of everything else. Mm-hmm. We don't have ego clashes in this group. People assume that we did because there was strife. But the strife is all about, should we play it like this or should we play it like that? Should this be loud? Should it be quiet? Should it be fast? Should it be slow? Should it be a guitar solo? Should it be a groove? Should it be 16 bars or 8 bars? And we really care. Each one of us has a really clear idea of how it should be.
But there's a lot of tension and spark with that. And I think that really translates to the audience. There must be some reason why we're popular. Why? I mean, is it just the songs or is it when we get on stage, there's something that happens and people sense... You know, they're not sure what's going to happen. Actually, we're really good friends. I love these guys.
We still have a little bust up now, but somehow that makes the band exciting. I think people like that idea of tension.
I mean, on another level, one thing I would say is that, you know,
it's nice to make so many people happy, because clearly everybody's very happy to see us and they hear the old songs and they're all great and we put on a good show. And on a really simple level, it's like, this is a great thing, you know.
Somehow this thing thrown together works. I don't quite know why, but it certainly does. I mean, you saw the show last night, people are going crazy.
There came a time during the tour, we had, you know, the three of us had to hold hands. We do a lot of that. Confessed, give it up, you know, just to hang our heads in humility and recognize that we are the hottest band in the fucking world.
Ask us what's it like to be in this situation, you know, the cliche of being a rock star in a rock band, because I guess the perception is that it's very different and a very exotic way of living, way of being. Our case is peculiar, and I think in the sense that we've come back to it being like a star rock band and sort of coming back into this lifestyle that goes with the tour. At least we don't live like this at home, where you know, it's fairly opulent. Obviously, we're catered to pretty much hand and foot.
Can we arrange for another door for Andy for Mr. Reinhardt?
I got two, and you've only got one.
No, there's actually two right here.
Okay, that's fine then.
Here is the hotel directory explaining all our services.
Oh, good.
All caviar and Porto menu.
Good, I need a little one.
All
provided. The adequate television, yes.
And this
looks like Andy's.
Well, actually, yeah. You know what? If you wish, I can have that door unlocked.
Andy and I don't want to have connecting space.
Okay.
I think we all have our little routines. Some of us are a little bit more ritualized than others, but ritual is very important because it's a buildup. It's all part of the working day. This moment right here is all part of the same experience that's gonna get me to that shower at the end of the show.
There is a certain amount of ritual. It's ritualized and we're used to it. I think everybody sort of enjoys it.
5 o'clock, we have a sound check. But before that, I come to my dressing room. This is my dressing room. It's the same decor every day. Kind of looks a bit exotic.
Check the dressing room. Cool. Go straight to the stage. And we do our sound check. Sometimes have tense moments of earnest and frank discussion. But generally, we're just looking for things to noodle, things to tweak, things to fix.
There's a tag, yeah. And then there's a whole section.
Yeah. It always sounds like you go to him and say, oh, like that.
I count.
Sounds like you're like, when we finish the sound check, we each fan out again. We don't see each other again pretty much until we're on stage.
I used to believe in love. You use it just like a glove.
We've been supported by my son's band, Fiction Plays. So I used to go out and watch them to see how they're doing and, you know, feel the vibe of the crowd. That gets me excited.
Can't do.
after Fiction Plane had gone off, I come back and really start warming up, humming and do some scales so that I don't surprise my voice when I walk on stage.
Warm up my wrists, I got my thing here to stretch my muscles.
And then I go around and see the other guys in the band. I see Stuart and Andy and a bit of a cuddle.
What's it going to be tonight then?
I was going to wear like the blue long fur, you know.
Just
divine. Yeah, really cool.
Hair's growing out.
That's good, those trousers and those shoes.
Yep.
Hey, you're done?
I'm done, mate. Done.
Here we go. Amazing. Oh, it happens, doesn't it? Like, 1 minute in ordinary mode, and then suddenly.
The transformation is complete.
The transformation? Yeah, perfect. My cure.
Everybody's a little bit different with what they need, and I've tried different things at different stages of my playing career of how to arrive on stage and feeling right.
Yeah, I have a little bit of ginseng, haven't I? It's good. Just get the old ginseng.
American ginseng.
Yes, Charlie.
This is the battle of it. 25 every day.
A very good feeling coming back and doing all this again. It sort of makes everything whole that we could go through this and somehow we've paid off our past. We've come out and played for all the people who made us successful in the first place.
Usually the three of us will stand around together for a bit. Kind of vibe each other.
When we started out, there was a lot of tension of working with each other. You know, it wasn't easy, and we had to deal with it. But as soon as we're inside that stage, we're good. We're good.
Stand by, Riser. Go, Riser.
Mounting the stage is always a triumphant sensation. You know that you've got the goods, all those people. Love is in the air. Something really unexpected about this whole endeavor, which is the ceremony of it. It's so alien from all of our instincts, which is when you're in a band, you're in business to create new stuff. In the Police, we are not in that business. Roxanne. Because we've discovered that something much more powerful than a new song is an old song. Work a street for money. You don't care if it's wrong or if it's when we go out there and play these songs, it's not just because Roxanne is a great song, Message in a Bottle, a great song. I mean, they are great songs. Not just because we're such incredible players. It's because these songs have 20 years of people's lives infused in them. They have this emotional baggage that you just can't get with a new song.
I mean, I see people, I start crying. I see couples turn to face one another and sort of fall in love again and kiss. I mean, it's this kind of range of emotions, and it, some nights it's hard not to get caught up in it.
Is immense.
Each audience out there, whatever they get from that show, it really does come back at you. You know, there are these phenomenon of people infused with spiritual fervor who can walk across coals and stuff like that. That's sort of what we get from the audience.
I suppose it's therapy. You know, I'm not a particularly extrovert person. I'm quite shy. I don't necessarily want to draw attention to myself ever. But somehow on the stage, all of that goes the other way.
You sort of transcend your own limitations. For a while there, it sort of becomes extraordinary. These are the moments that you live for. This is the drug that always brings you back.
There's a great deal of joy in singing. That freedom you have to soar. When you do hit those notes, it's glorious, and you see the effect it has on people. I won't say you're with another boy. A lot of the time, I'm in a kind of ecstasy.
They're really with you and pushing you. Then you start to transcend everything. It becomes like one organism, the band and the audience.
And I think the good energy that you get from the audience, you know, night after night, starts to wash through, and then we start to feel like we're all together.
I feel there's a rightness to it, a chemistry between the individual members of the group, which is hard to kind of define. Play well. It's just something happens and people respond to it.
It's like having a conversation, and it's when you sort of know what someone's going to say before they say it, and you're with them.
I'm in the lyric, and not so much the meaning of the lyric, but the rhythm and the melody of the lyric, so that I can get out of its way, so that I can be an envelope around it.
It's absolute focus and attention to what you're doing. I don't let my mind wander from that. So it is a kind of trance, but it's a very conscious and focused trance.
Getting it together, it's like you channel this feeling. It's almost shamanic, I suppose. It becomes tribal. I can't stand there with all that energy and feel upset about anything. It sort of tends to minimize problems in life.
All three of us have pulled ourselves together and given it up. And the more that we've given it up, the better the music has become.
It's clear that something is going on that you couldn't really plan for. Somehow it works. It's like a machine that works. Sort of cock-eyed machine.
For the seedy part of